threat has been detected.
A good analogy for a virus would be similar to termites. They can be in your house right now, you don't even know about it. And when you finally find out is when it's too late.
On March the 6th, when your computer turns on, it realizes it's that day and will start to wreck information on your hard disk.
Remember 10 to 20 years ago when we were all scared about getting a computer virus? We would pay for antivirus protection from companies like McAfee and Norton just so that we wouldn't get a Trojan virus. But somehow, despite all our efforts, getting a virus was often an inevitability. And then we'd have to put our computers into safe mode, delete recently downloaded files, run virus scans, and hope and pray that the computer will actually boot up the next time, and that no data was corrupted or lost. But nowadays, the thought of a computer virus destroying our computer rarely crosses our mind. In fact, many of us have completely stopped purchasing external antivirus protection. Yet our computer experience is better than ever, and we don't even have to deal with those slow virus scans. So, did computer viruses just get eradicated like polio or smallpox? But wait, that can't be true because we still hear about data breaches and hacks all the time. So, clearly, computers and code still have a bunch of vulnerabilities. But then, what happened to traditional computer viruses? Before we answer why viruses are no longer a big threat for most of us, we have to understand how viruses work in the first place. Computer viruses have been around for a long time, with the first one called Creeper dating back to 1971. The mechanics of the virus was extremely simple. Once the virus was placed inside a local hard drive, it would just keep replicating itself until the given computer ran out of space and became inoperational. At this point, the virus would taunt the user with the message, "I'm the Creeper, catch me if you can." Fortunately, the Creeper wasn't hard to catch because it came along with an antidote called Reaper. This is because Creeper wasn't actually designed with malicious intent. It was simply supposed to demonstrate basic computer vulnerabilities and how these shortfalls could be addressed. But the days of benign experimental viruses didn't last long. As soon as computers became generally available, a new subset of people called hackers started trying to reverse engineer code, and we started seeing much more deadly viruses. This included the first real-world virus called Brain in 1986. Unlike Creeper, Brain didn't just aim to waste your hard drive space. Brain was trying to corrupt your computer, and it did this by latching onto your boot disk. From there, Brain would move your real boot sector to another location and mark it as bad. In the meantime, it would overwrite your original boot sector with the virus, making it impossible to boot the computer. The next prominent computer virus, Michelangelo, appeared in 1991 and worked in a very similar fashion, but with a unique twist. Instead of corrupting the computer as soon as Michelangelo made contact, Michelangelo would wait until March 6th of every year. This way, no one would really know how much the virus had spread. And then suddenly, on March 6th, the virus would overwrite the first 100 sectors with zeros, and everyone would be screwed over at the same time. This strategy was especially effective as the virus would end up infecting 20,000 computers. But the next virus was so much bigger that Michelangelo would look like a school project. Ironically though, the next virus, CIH, was developed by a university student and launched in 1998. The motive? Well, the university student wanted to put overconfident software engineers in their place. And I think it's safe to say that that goal was destroyed. Once CIH made it to a user's computer, it would overwrite the hard drive, the boot sector, and even the BIOS. Similar to Michelangelo, CIH was designed to remain dormant for 1 month before starting its rampage, but when the virus was triggered, it was absolutely deadly. CIH would end up infecting a whopping 60 million computers and causing $1 billion worth of damage. For the first time, computer viruses weren't just a nuisance. They were an actual international threat, and this threat would only get even bigger with the internet. Up until now, the main culprit spreading viruses were shared floppy disks, but let's just say the internet was much more viral. The first prominent internet virus came in 1999, and it was called Melissa. Melissa was distributed through email, and once you received Melissa, it would automatically be sent to 50 of your contacts. Fortunately, Melissa wasn't malicious. Some would even call it a social service, as Melissa was simply distributing passwords to adult websites. but its successor, I Love You in 2000, wasn't nearly as kind. On the surface, I Love You was a simple text file that was spread through email. But behind the scenes, it was actually a Visual Basic Script or AVBS that could overwrite Office, image, and audio files. And thanks to the virality of the internet, it would spread to 50 million computers in less than 10 days. This marked the beginning of the peak computer virus era. But within the next 10 to 15 years, this fear would disappear as if it never existed in the first place. So, what in the world happened? Well, as you saw with all those viruses, there's only two ways that they can spread: shared storage devices and the internet. The first medium was naturally eliminated thanks to the internet. Now that people could email each other, there was less of a need to share floppy disks or USB sticks. If you were going to use an external storage device, it was more than likely just for personal use. So the storage device medium kind of died out on its own, but the internet medium was much harder to address. A lot of this process simply consisted of small improvements to security over a long time period. But there was a pinpointable event that leaped forward internet security, and that was the ditching of Internet Explorer. Back in 2004, the market share of Internet Explorer peaked at 95%. Most of you probably remember IE as the slow, buggy, crappy browser. But it was much worse than just that, as it also had serious security vulnerabilities. You see, IE didn't just allow for the execution of JavaScript, which is the standard for websites. IE also allowed for the execution of VB scripts, which gave the browser access to the computer. This probably sounds like a stupid idea, but there was reason for it. Ideally, this would allow websites to accomplish much more advanced tasks as they had access to the computer. But this also meant that they could accomplish much more nefarious tasks, and that's exactly what happened. Microsoft didn't really do much about this other than putting out a tutorial on how to disable VB script execution. But let's be honest, this was not something that the average user was ever going to do. Something that the average user did do though was ditch Internet Explorer and move to Chrome. Unlike Microsoft, Google did not support VB script, which made these viruses virtually useless. This meant that the storage device medium and the direct from browser medium were effectively cut off, which left us with just the downloading medium. The eradication of this medium came down to multiple factors, starting with constant updates. Before 2010, there was really no such thing as regular updates. You got a version of Windows when you bought your PC, and you would have this version up until you got another PC. But moving into the 2010s, constant over-the-air updates became a thing. And while these updates somehow always happened at the worst times possible, they did wonders for computer security. Viruses no longer had ears on end to keep exploiting the same bugs and glitches. As soon as a virus was discovered, companies were able to patch it and send out an update. We should also mention that companies started taking cybersecurity much more seriously. Between 2010 and 2018 alone, cybersecurity spending rocketed from $27.4 billion to $66 billion. These companies built out entire cybersecurity departments filled with extraordinarily talented and well-paid engineers. At Microsoft, for example, security analysts are paid $272,000 on average. Speaking of compensation, companies also started dissuading hackers by straight up bribing them. Google, for instance, offers $1 million if you can hack Chrome. Similarly, Apple is offering $1.5 million if you can hack the iPhone. And these companies end up paying out several people every single year, and in return, they're able to prevent exploits that may have harmed hundreds of millions of users. In the meantime, users have also gotten much more tech-savvy when it comes to protecting their devices. We should also mention that our internet usage has also become much more focused. While we all spend more time than ever on the internet, virtually all of our usage has to do with reputable companies and brands like Google, Facebook, Microsoft, Apple, and Amazon. So the chances that we're even exposed to a virus is significantly lower than 10 to 20 years ago. And when you put all of these factors together, you get the virus-free era. None of this is to say that computer viruses are completely gone though. The number of bad actors and threats are actually larger than ever. And one of the main reasons that we don't see viruses affect us is because bad actors no longer target everyday users. Back in the day, the only incentive of creating a virus was to make a splash in the tech scene and or expose vulnerabilities. But nowadays, hacking is a lot more profitable, and I'm not talking about selling your hacks to big name companies. I'm talking about using exploits to steal loads of data and operate international cybercrime rings that do everything from creating fake IDs to credit card fraud. And this makes perfect sense. Let's say you find a data exploit in Windows after years of work. Would you rather try to spread this virus amongst everyday users and display some sort of corny gotcha message, or would you rather target an institution? I mean, the answer is obvious. Stealing the data of 100 million users from T-Mobile is infinitely more valuable than corrupting random people's PCs. This information is literally worth billions. Given that you'll have to sell it through dark avenues, you'll probably have to accept a deep discount and sell it for hundreds of millions. But that's still 100 times what Google is willing to pay you for that exploit. Also, even if you were going for everyday people, the goal would not be to screw up their machine. In fact, the goal would be the exact opposite, as you wouldn't even want the user to notice. Ideally, the virus should be able to collect data permanently and not inhibit any functionality whatsoever. If you do this at scale, you can have constant streams of data from tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of people. And thanks to cryptocurrency, hackers are able to transact insane amounts of money with ease. This one hacker, for example, claims that he owns $7 billion worth of Bitcoin, making him the 369th richest person in the world. So while viruses no longer affect us directly, they're still very much a major threat. In the end, we all remember computer viruses as a symbol of computers throughout the 2000s. Thanks to much safer browsers, constant updates, hard security departments, and much more savvy users, traditional computer viruses have become a thing of the past. But this isn't to say that cybersecurity threats have been completely eliminated altogether. Rather, they've simply shifted in their form and their motive. Viruses today don't aim to slow down your computer or corrupt it. They aim to steal your data and sell it for millions. And judging by the constant data leaks that we see on a regular basis, it looks like there's still a long way to go. But hey, at least we don't have to deal with Trojan viruses and safe mode anymore. When was the last time that you had a computer virus? Comment that down below. Also, drop a like if you're glad that we're past traditional viruses. And of course, consider checking out our Discord community to suggest future video ideas and consider subscribing to see more questions logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.